Hello everyone, welcome to Study to Win Education. In this particular lecture of sine bar, I am going to teach a use of a sine bar for angle measurement in a metrology. This is a particular setup of sine bar. Let's look into detail how the sine bar can be used. So sine bar is the topic of today's lecture. Here is the typical sine bar drawn. This is made up of high carbon steel and it is a kind of bar, so it is called as a sine bar. It is actually in 3D, it will look like this, something like this. So this is a solid bar and it has a key features like this top surface is very much polished, this bottom surface is also very much polished, and the roller surfaces are also very much polished. These are the circles indicate the holes present in the sine bar because this is a heavy metal block, so weight will be very high. For weight reduction purpose, material saving purpose, it has a holes made in it. Accuracy of a sine bar will depend on three things. Number one, the parallelism of the top surface and bottom surface. These two surfaces should be very much parallel. Second, the axis of the rollers should be exactly parallel with each other. That is the second factor that will affect the accuracy of sine bar or the accuracy of the angle measured by the sine bar. And the third factor indicate the diameter of these rollers should be exactly equal to each other. These are the three factors on which the accuracy of sine bar will depend. The distance between rollers will be a standard distance and that is generally denoted by L, and this distance is generally 200 mm, 100 mm, 300 mm, so on. And with the help of this distance only we designate the sine bar, like 200 mm sine bar, 300 mm sine bar, so on. So this is for introduction of a sine bar. Now I will draw a diagram for use of a sine bar. We have this sine bar kept on a surface table. So this is a surface table. Friends, sine bar is not a complete instrument in itself. Why? Because only having a sine bar will not give you the exact angle. Sine bar is always worked in association with slip gauges, dial indicator, and obviously a dial indicator stand. These are the additional instruments required while working with a sine bar. Here, this is a surface table on which I have kept the sine bar. One roller of the sine bar is rested on the surface table. Another roller is kept on the slip gauge so that the top surface of the workpiece will become horizontal. So this is the workpiece for which I want to measure the angle. So this is the workpiece and it has some angle theta and I want to measure this angle. So what you have to do, you have to keep this workpiece on the sine bar like I have kept here. But since this workpiece will slide down on the sine bar, we have some stopper arrangement as well on a sine bar here, so that this workpiece will not slide down. And we have this slip gauge height S here. And then we have to put the dial indicator on the surface of the workpiece to check if it is really horizontal or not. This is the dial gauge indicator, dial indicator. Now here you should understand that the size of or height of the slip gauge will be decided based on the dial gauge reading. That means I kept the workpiece on the sine bar and I lifted the one end of the sine bar up using the slip gauge height, and I found that the reading of the dial gauge is some reading we have got here at this point, and then I check the reading at this point. I come to know that this end of this workpiece is little lower than this end using the dial gauge indicator reading. That means I have to raise this end of the sine bar so that I can add the slip gauge under the this roller. And I will one more time check the reading of the dial gauge at this end and the reading of the dial gauge at this end. When I get these two readings exactly same, that means this particular surface is exactly horizontal with respect to this surface table. That means our aim is to make this particular surface exactly parallel to the surface table, and that for that purpose we are using a dial gauge. Now suppose we have already got the surface parallel with the surface table and we required the slip gauge block of size S. Let's say we have a size S slip gauge block. Now you have to apply a simple geometrical formula sine theta is equal to S upon L. Now I will tell you how this formula we have arrived. This is a center of ruler, this is another center of ruler. Join it by a dotted line, it is a construction line. Draw a parallel line with respect to surface table and then a vertical line. Let's say this is a center O1, this is O2 and this is E. Now we have to find this angle theta, and which has a value nothing but equal to this angle theta. This theta value is nothing but this theta value, because we know this principle, this theta is equal to this theta. That is what we have applied here. Now apply the sine theta to the angle O2 O1 A. What we got? We got sine theta is equal to S, or we got sine theta is equal to O2 A by O1 O2. We already know what the O1 O2 is. O1 O2 is a standard length of a sine bar. Let's say here it is equal to L. Now O2 A is nothing but S. Why? Because we have to find O2 A. O2 A is nothing but radius of this roller plus slip gauge height minus roller of this radius of this roller. That means here we are adding the roller height. Sorry, here we are subtracting the roller radius, and here we are adding the roller radius. That means we can cancel it out, and what remains as a size side O2 A is slip gauge block height, that is equal to S. Now with simple formula, theta is equal to sine inverse of S upon L, we can find the angle theta. So this is how a sine bar is used. Now suppose you have a bigger component for a sine bar assessment. Let's say this is a surface table again, on which I keep the component which is having a size bit larger. The problem is this much large object will not be kept on a sine bar, because if the sine bar is smaller than the object, then what can be done in that cases? So that is what I am showing here. You have to keep the sine bar on the object in that case, like this. So this is where you have to keep the sine bar on the object. This is a workpiece, and measure the heights of the roller using the height gauge. Now I will keep the height gauge at this roller, and I will measure this height, and I will call it, this is H2, and I will call this height gauge reading as a H1. Now again apply the same principle. Here is the center of the roller, and join it, and you will get a triangle again here. Let's say this is A, this is O1, this is O2. Now in triangle, or in angle O2 O1A, apply a sine theta. Sine theta is equal to O2A upon O1 O2 again. Our aim is to find this theta, and this theta is nothing but this theta. Why? Because this is a horizontal line, this is also a horizontal line, this is an inclined line, and this is a parallel to the this dotted line is parallel to this inclined line. That means this theta is nothing but this theta, and sine theta is equal to O2A by O1 O2, where O2A is nothing but H1 minus H2 divided by O1 O2 is nothing but length of sine bar. Here again with a simple formula, sine inverse of H1 minus H2 upon L will give you the exact angle of this theta. This is used in case the workpiece is larger than the sine bar. And now the accuracy or the error in the sine bar we will calculate. Sine bar is generally used for the angle measurements up to or less than 45 degree. The reason is, I will explain. S is equal to, or let's say sine theta is equal to S by L. This is what in a previous slide we have got the formula. What you have to do, you have to write it as a S is equal to L sine theta. Now derive it with respect to d theta and ds. So we have ds is equal to S into cos theta into d theta. That means here we get the equation as a d theta by ds is equal to 1 upon L sec theta. This shows that the error in the d theta is nothing but the error in angle measurement, and ds indicate the error in the height of a slip gauge. So this is the error in the angular measurement, which will increase as the theta increases. And if you draw the sec theta graph, this is, let's say, 45 degree, this is 90 degree. If you draw a sec theta graph, it will go like this. It will at 0, sec 0 is 0. Then it starts like this, and then after 45, it rises exponentially. It rises like anything. And that is why the d theta by ds value is limited up to 45 degree. The error is minimum. After 45 degree, this error increases very much, and it unacceptable. And that's why we limit the use of a sine bar to only 45 degree. This is the reason. Thanks for watching the video. If you have any doubt in this lecture, please write it in a comment. If you are not subscribed to the channel, please subscribe and share this video with your friends. Thanks for watching the video. Have a great day. Thank you.